Welcome to Macworld Expo, the Macworld booth. I am Macworld's Chris Breen. I am joined by Andy Ihnatko, star of stage and screen, Chicago Sun-Times columnist, CBS personality, frequent contributor to Macworld, and book author featuring such books as iPod and iPhone Fully Loaded, or iPhone Fully Loaded.
Oh, God bless you for mentioning that, yes.
Thank you. And it's Friday. We're here at the Expo show floor, and it is packed, as it was yesterday.
Yep, it's damn packed. I mean, I think all of us didn't know what we would see here, given that when Apple pulls out, that's not a really good sign for drawing people in. But one of the first things I saw, even before I hit the show floor, was people complaining that, my God, we can't really walk around here, this is terrible. Like, no, that's wonderful that you can't walk around. Unless Paul basically decided to have it in a 200-square-foot area, just to sort of like make sure that people look like there's a lot of things going on. Then no, it's a far, it was the full hall, and it's a lot of action, lots of buzz. I'm amazed that we can hear each other.
Yeah, and what surprised me is as I walked around the show floor yesterday, it felt exactly like Macworld. It didn't feel like the last Macworld or, it's sort of a poor substitute for Macworld.
No one's singing Anna Tevka today, no.
Yeah, so I saw a lot of the same people I see around. There are lots of vendors here, not as many as there were in the past. But it seems like a viable show.
Yeah, and that's actually partly a win for the smaller publishers because, I mean, Omni Group is normally one of the better booths at this show, but now they have the prestige and the presence of like an Adobe or a Microsoft,
right,
or even an Apple, because they were very, very aggressive in putting out a lot of really cool announcements just a couple weeks beforehand. So there are a lot of people dropping by just to see what's going on there. And it is a place where you can get attention, both as a user, as a member of the media, and as someone who with something to sell.
Yeah. Now, one thing that I noticed, and you probably had the same experience, when I was at CES, I talked to a lot of vendors who were normally at Macworld Expo, and a lot of them said, you know, we're going to wait and see what kind of numbers they draw. If this is an example of what we can expect, I think you can go back to those vendors and say, okay.
That's pretty good. And remember that we're still, you know, this is still a school day. This is where all these people have jobs, hopefully, and schools to be at. Tomorrow, I think that's the first time in I don't know how many Macworld Expos we've had a Macworld Expo day on a weekend. And I just can't wait to see how many people are going to be here on Saturday.
Yeah, I think that should be interesting because I haven't done a Saturday. I think way back in the early days they did, but that was quite a long time ago. Now, yesterday you did a presentation out here on the show floor, and it was the year of no media?
The year of no media. Yeah, that was something I did last year. I did a little experiment where I spent the entire calendar year trying to buy zero physical media of any kind. That if I wanted to get informed or entertained by anything, I could not buy a book or a CD or a DVD or borrow any of those things. I have to get it by as a sloppy pile of electrons, no matter how I could get it. And I did it for all my research. I did it for magazines, books, movies, music, comic books, everything. And it was pretty much just an experiment to see how far along we've gotten in this mythical transition to all digital media.
So how far have we gotten?
Pretty good. I presented it as a scorecard, really, as a grade book, because there are many areas in which you're basically at an A- at least. Music, if you want any piece of music, obviously you can get it on iTunes. Movies, I found pretty much the same thing. It's not as though you can find everything you ever wanted on the iTunes store or available via Netflix streaming, but the worthy alternative is that if I come in looking for The Sting on Netflix and I find out that, no, it's not available for streaming, it'll suggest at least three or four other movies that are sort of similar to it that are available for streaming. So I still get to the destination I wanted, which was 90 minutes to 2 hours of really good entertainment available via digital. There are a couple areas that were total failures, though. One of them was comic books. Mm-hmm. There is just no solution to comic books digitally right now, which is ironic given that with the iPad, so much buzz is around what comic publishers are going to do. There are at least three different major distributors of digital comics that are here at the show. But as far as here and now, if you want the experience of I've heard about this comic and I want to get it digitally, or I keep reading Justice League every single month and I want to be able to read it every month digitally, the only solution is steal it. Go into Bitport and download it illegally, which is terrible. And I did it long enough to prove that this was a viable way of doing things. But really, after February, after I proved to myself that, yes, it's that easy to get that, that meant that I could not, I stopped doing it, which meant that I read no comic books pretty much for 10 months.
Okay. So when you give this same talk a year from now, how is it going to change because of the iPad?
I think that the biggest change will be in books, chiefly because every single major publisher is going to get super aggressive in making their electronic business just as important to them as their digital business. Mm-hmm. Right now, believe it or not, the success of the Amazon store has been holding back electronic publishing, because it's sort of like when GM made an electric car that they really didn't want to make.
Right.
If you force and twist, they were making digital books, even though they didn't feel as though, with the pricing structure and the profit structure that Amazon was imposing, they couldn't make any real money off of it, enough to keep it going, and plus they felt it was an investment on the future, but they didn't really think that this was going to be part of their real business. Now that Apple has sort of strong-armed Amazon by being as gracious to the publishers as possible, saying, by all means, charge as much as you want. We know we don't want half of, why would we take half of your profits? We'll take the normal 30% we charge anybody else. Mm-hmm. That will give them much more opportunities to make money off of these things, which will mean that we'll stop seeing a division between the titles that they publish electronically and the ones that they only publish in hardcover.
Now, I have mixed feelings on this, on the pricing issue, because when we were talking about music, Apple said, no, we're going to hold the line at 99 cents. Everybody cheered. Apple said, yes, that's right. And then Amazon attempts to do something similar with book publishers, and everybody says, oh, Amazon, you terrible people for doing that. What am I missing here? What's the difference?
Well, probably because there was no digital store for digital content of any kind before iTunes came on.
Right.
Apple had a very, very clear vision of, here's what we'll take to make all this work. One of them is going to have to be, we don't want people to have to look at what the price is for this track and think, gee, I would have bought this, but, oh, I feel like I got hoodwinked. This hit single cost $2.79 just because it's being heavily promoted and heavily
right.
hyped. The fact that every track costs 99 cents, which is a very, very manageable psychologically amount of money to spend.
Sure.
It's a different thing when you're talking about books. There's not going to be, there's free, and then there's $7.99, $8.99. There really is no 99-cent book.
Right.
Anybody who's charging you 99 cents is charging you for a book that you should be able to download for free.
Yeah.
So it really doesn't work that way. Also, people have been trained to buy things electronically now. So you don't really need to make that kind of sacrifice to make this store work. They have a whole mechanism that's in place. They have a whole marketing thing that's in place, and they've proven that they can make people money off of this model. And to be fair, realize that Apple themselves dropped the flat pricing scheme a couple years ago themselves.
Right, right. Now, you've been talking to comic book publishers and some other publishers. Do you think Apple is going to get into periodicals, newspapers, journals, comic books, or do you think they really just want to be in the books business and then everything else is going to be app-based?
That is a really big mystery question. Even now, I'm working all my sources to get tidbits about where iBooks is going to be in terms
right.
of content. I don't know of any publisher that is ready to abandon the app concept right now, because they know that if they keep investing in this in their own little platforms for apps, that they know that they'll have something to sell on day one when the iPad ships.
Right.
As opposed to waiting a few months for a specification to come in and then hoping they get authorized to join the bookshelves along with Macmillan and all these other publishers. Also, remember that they don't want to just sell stuff to iPad users. I think that the smart companies are developing, when they develop their workflows for electronic publishing, their mind is on a WebKit renderer so that they can build their own little application for the iPad that mm-hmm. essentially is just uses the built-in WebKit library
right.
to render these pages and lay them out. But that also means that, well, guess what? Android's browser also incorporates WebKit, so it will be not a very difficult thing to create an Android version of this app. Realize that most of the cool stuff out of CES were people getting ready for the iPad announcement by saying, we've got our own Android-based tablet,
yeah.
but unlike Apple, we're going to charge you just $500 or $600 for ours, not $1,000. I bet that's going to change a lot of things, but you get the point.
I imagine so. So as from the point of view from content creators, as we are, we look at, we've been writing traditional books for a long time. The iPad comes along, and suddenly every writer I've talked to, the wheels are turning and thinking, let's see, there's this onerous book contract, or there's self-publishing, and maybe I could do this myself. What do you think about the future of authors going out and doing it on their own?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. I don't know. I myself have been teaming up with developers on basically creating an ebook reader, more like an ebook wrapper, that I could just stick content in and just self-publish whatever I want to do.
Right.
I think it's going to be a lot trickier than people think it is.
Yeah.
Because it's one thing to have a... What when you start self-publishing, what you realize that you're missing is this big evil publisher that does things like talk to Barnes & Noble about getting your book in their Christmas catalog,
yeah.
and making sure that the company, the bookstore that buys a lot of similar titles will also want to buy your title as well.
Mm-hmm.
It is really, really sometimes a soul-killing process to have to be there peddling your little book saying, please, sir, I spent 3 months of my life on it. I'd like to have the heat turned on pretty soon. It's only a dollar. Like, well, give us 4 freebies and we'll think about it.
Yeah.
And people like you and I are in a much better position, which means that when we have success, thank God, hopefully, if we have success in that sort of thing,
yeah.
people will forget that, yeah, but you know what? Those guys have 20,000 or 30,000 Twitter followers. When we announce that we have a new book on the App Store, we can count on at least 700 people immediately at least taking a look at it.
Right.
There's a good chance that because, not that there's a log rolling procedure going on, but I'm very interested. I know that the stuff that you write about the iPod is fantastic, and if you tell me you're writing a book about it, just as a consumer, I want to read it.
Right.
And part of my job is things that I'm excited about recommending to other people. So we're sort of in there already with a good chance of being able to make enough money off of self-publishing that we can have a good run of it. I think that's going to disillusion a lot of people, though, as they realize that they're just going to have to spend a lot of time just beating the tub and trying to get attention for their books.
Well, I agree, because you look at the Leo Laporte model, where people say, oh, I could make a fortune as a podcaster.
Right.
And it's like, well, yes, but Leo had an audience of millions of people. So once he started doing this and doing really quality work, of course everybody's following me and he's doing very well. But to aspire to be that Leo Laporte when you are
yeah.
a guy in the basement.
And then also the need to create your own ebook reader, if that's going to be necessary, is also going to be a big problem.
Right.
Because getting back to Leo, you forget that he wasn't just some dude with a webcam. He set up a real studio. He has background there. He set up a really professional studio.
Right.
He aspired to a immediately tangible level of quality in all the broadcast he does. The equivalent for that on self-publishing is going to be an ebook reader that looks like it was designed by somebody who designed these things for a living. A very clean, very slick user interface, no stuttering when you turn pages.
Mm-hmm.
At no point do you stare at thing looking for a button that's not there that you would expect to be there.
Right.
And if there's a danger to this, it's going to be like that there would be a glut or an implosion, that there's so many books on Mac OS X Snow Leopard that the 10 that are really, really good are going to get buried under everybody who said, well, you know what, I developed this training guide for my insurance company as an IT guy, and so I just decided I'm going to just drop the PDF into this application and publish it. So that guy might get as much attention if someone just searches for macOS 10.6 books as I would, because we're just getting the same amount of keywords.
Right, and I also have to think that a lot of people are thinking, oh, well, this is just simply going to be a translation from text to electronics. But for these things to be successful and worthwhile and make you abandon a paper book, they have to have rich media involved as well. And I don't know that just anybody can do this sort of thing.
Yeah, I mean, the best ones are going to involve screencasts just built in, and not even the silly demonstrations that you often see, like at Microsoft CES keynote, of where you have a book and there's a color picture, and if you tap the picture, it turns into a movie. We're going to see the people who really shine are the ones who figure out when it's really appropriate to show the motion of here's how to use a spring-loaded folder and do it in such a way that it just doesn't look like we're bringing the entire book to a stop so you can see this piece of canned animation. So it seems as though, almost as if you have a copy of the Finder there on your iPad or there on your iPhone that you can then access whenever you want.
Right.
So money, time, intellect, creativity, product is always going to be the solution, not the technology.
Right, yeah. It should be a very interesting year ahead for a lot of people, and particularly people in our business. So what does the rest of the show hold for you? What else do you have on your schedule before you jet out of town?
Just a lot of walking around. I've barely made a dent in all the vendor booths, and this is going to be particularly valuable for guys like us in the media, because there are a lot of very, like I was saying earlier, a lot of very small publishers that you don't tend to run across on a day-to-day basis. So I've got a couple more podcasts to do. I'm going to be interviewing Scott Kurtz, who's one of my favorite webcomics creators,
right.
on stage in about an hour or so. Meanwhile, I've got my own job, my own business to run, so I got to finish a column for my bosses at the Sun Times at some
right.
point. And there will be food. There will be a dinner.
And there will be
a dinner.
And food.
A dinner must be had.
Excellent. Okay, well, I will let you get to it then. Where can people learn more about Andy Ihnatko and your work?
Well, my main site is at Ihnatko.com. If you can't spell Ihnatko, spell CWOB.com for the celestial waste of bandwidth. And that will take you to all my sites, my email addresses, my Flickr, my Twitter, all that sort of stuff that hopefully gets you so interested in what I'm doing that you'll, at some point, indirectly or directly, lead me to be able to afford more trips like this one.
Terrific. Thanks very much for joining me, Andy.
It's been a slice. Okay.